Now I would ask Dr. Sanjay Aher. As you know, he is a famous neonatologist, neonatal intensivist at NEOCARE Hospital, Nashik.
Good morning, Hiran, and all my teachers, seniors, and friends. I welcome you on behalf of organizing committee of Mahaneocon and Nashikon 2019. So previous speakers have made my job very difficult because they had such a wonderful talks before me. So now I have to do better. So this is my setup in Nashik. So what I'm going to cover in this 25 minutes talk. I'm going to talk about golden hour strategy. Then what are the current resuscitation recommendations for extremely low birth weight babies? Very important thing is temperature management. Then few words about delayed cord clamping. Then what specific things we can do as far as respiratory support is concerned. What are the recommendations for oxygen use and specific issues of these little ones? So we had NRP workshop yesterday and we have learned that in resuscitation, ventilation, ventilation, ventilation. That is the only thing we have to remember. Primary apnea, we can give tactile stimulation, but secondary apnea, we have to ventilate the baby. This delivery room is a very stressful environment where decisions are made very quickly and the resuscitator, the doctor, need to be very skilled in clinical assessment, decision making and ventilation of these babies. So what are the limitations of these babies who are born extremely low birth weight? So their lungs are structurally immature. There is no surfactant. They are not supported by a stiff chest wall. And they are very susceptible to injury leading to chronic lung disease in these babies. So resuscitation of these premature babies is the time period during which the infant faces challenges that carry risk of short as well as long-term injury, lifelong developmental delay, and even death. So the decisions taken by a doctor during this time are based on multiple systems that require attention, knowing that care in these first minutes can translate into lifelong medical problems. So what is a golden hour strategy? So communication and collaboration. Inter as well as intra team using evidence-based protocols and procedures. It's not only among the pediatrician or neonatologist team going to the delivery, but with the obstetrician who are delivering these babies. The communication is very, very important. To standardize as many elements as possible for delivery and initial management of these babies, then we have to have good communication, as I already said, with the obstetric services of an impending preterm birth. Then there is the importance of collaborative counseling of the family, then pre-resuscitation checklist, and clearly assigning the role and responsibilities for the person. There should not be a chaos. When we go to delivery of a preterm baby, everyone must know what is his responsibility. Who is going to take care of airway? Who is going to take care of chest compression? Who is going to call ambulance? Who is going to inform the hospital? So these roles has to be assigned in advance, so that there is no communication gap at the time of delivery. So in short, this first golden hour for this extremely low birth weight infant is nothing but an excellent teamwork. So what are the cornerstones of this bundle? Thermoregulation, respiratory support, cardiovascular support, and nutritional support, which starts in delivery room and then continues into the NICU. So what are the problems these babies have? They are more prone to hypothermia, they have very poor energy stores, immature tissues, very weak chest muscles, immature nervous system that may lead to poor respiratory drive. Then, as I said, surfactant deficiency is a big problem. Then there is increased risk of infection in these babies, and that is the major problem when we treat these babies. Sepsis is the major problem because underdeveloped immune system in these babies. Then they have very fragile capillaries in the brain which can rupture and can give rise to intraventricular hemorrhage, which can have long-term problems. Then their total blood volume is also very low, so they are very susceptible to hypovolemic shock after delivery. And very important is highly stressed parents. We have to communicate with the parents. Rahul has done my job very easy. So That is very important thing. It is not only going to the delivery, but we have to do counseling before birth. And I'm very lucky that we have obstetricians among us today. And they are so particular. If they are expecting a baby 1 month from now, they will call me, Sanjay, we are going to have this preterm delivery. And I will send the parents to you. You talk to them and tell them everything. And yesterday only, madam told me maybe 1 month back that we are going to have preterms. And we discuss everything, but unfortunately that baby, those babies born yesterday, but still I went and did all things what they required. So that communication between an obstetrician and a pediatrician is very, very important, and we are so lucky. Then what are the resuscitation specification in these babies? So I'm going to discuss that in detail because you can't see everything in this slide. So what is the highest priority as far as resuscitation is concerned? So it may take longer than 30 seconds to establish effective ventilation. So you have to do these corrective actions like Mr. Sopa that is mentioned in our NRP guideline. Do not start chest compression without ensuring effective ventilation. You need additional resources in the delivery room like additional trained person, including some skill in intubation in these little babies, because it is very difficult to intubate a baby who is 700 or 800 gram. So we have to have a competent person who can immediately intubate this baby. Additional equipments, you should have compressed air, then oxygen blender, pulse oximeter, humidifier for oxygen administration. These are very important, and these are the new recommendation in new NRP guidelines. You have to put an oxygen pulse oximeter and start seeing the baby's saturation immediately. Then how to keep these babies warm? If baby is born before 28 weeks, we can use these plastic wraps. Unfortunately, the video is not working. Yeah, it is working now. So these plastic wraps are available. You can put the baby directly without drying the baby. You can put the baby inside this plastic wrap. And then you start resuscitation and transfer the baby in that plastic wrap till the NICU, and then you remove that plastic wrap and put the baby under Indian coma. It looks like it is very theoretical. Is it possible in Nashik? Yes, it is possible, and we are doing it since last 5-6 years. These plastic wraps are available for little babies. Whenever we get a baby who is below 1 kg, we always try to put that baby in this plastic wrap. It prevents them from going into hypothermia, because hypothermia is a prognosticating factor in these babies. Then how to decrease the injury to brain? So we have to be very gentle when we are handling these babies. Then avoid high pressures whenever possible, otherwise you will get in trouble because of pneumothorax. Then adjust ventilation gradually based on physical examination, pulse oximetry and blood gases. Avoid rapid intravenous fluid boluses and hypertonic solutions, because these babies can have intraventricular hemorrhage. So now in new NRP guidelines, there is no place for soda bicarbonate, no place for even Ringer's lactate. So only fluid recommended for newborn resuscitation is normal saline only. Or if you have O negative blood cross match with mother, that you can use. Then we are going to now discuss about specific steps for these extremely low birth weight babies. So first thing is temperature management. So we have already discussed this, why these babies become hypothermic, because they don't have enough brown fat. There is decreased subcutaneous fat, ineffective thermogenesis. Then these are what are the target temperature range? It is 36.5 to 37.5. Avoid hypothermia as well as hyperthermia. Both are dangerous for the baby. Then the perivival infant should be placed in high diathermic food grade polythene bags. We already saw that video. Then what extra care to be taken when we are using oxygen to these babies? So there is emerging evidence to use heated and humidified oxygen. Otherwise it will cause drying of the airways and baby can have more problems. Then avoid hyperthermia, as I said, avoid both hypo as well as hyperthermia. The next thing is delayed cord clamping. Dr. Jessel has already covered this topic. I'm just going to show one slide here. So there is new recommendation that delayed cord clamping for 30 to 60 seconds is reasonable for both term as well as preterm infant who doesn't require any resuscitation. But if there is baby has placenta, there was placenta previa, bleeding was a previa, cord avulsion, then you should avoid doing this. So extremely low birth weight infants not requiring immediate resuscitation should receive delayed cord clamping for at least 30 seconds. Next is very important as far as neonatologist and pediatrician is concerned, what respiratory support we should give to these extremely low birth weight infants. So what are our goals? We want to improve the compliance of the lung, decrease work of breathing, avoid apnea and provide assisted ventilation as needed, and the target is maintain functional residual capacity, use minimal oxygen concentration and avoid iatrogenic complications. So these are the three things which have some evidence. So first one is sustained inflation, but this meta-analysis of sustained inflation in delivery room reported significant reduction in need for mechanical ventilation in first 72 hours. Number needed to treat was 10, but there was increase in PDA treatment in infants receiving sustained inflation. Number needed to harm was 10. So more studies are needed before sustained inflation can be routinely practiced in delivery room. The second thing is CPAP, and we have so much evidence about it. We had a special workshop yesterday on CPAP. So it prevents collapse of the surfactant deficient lungs. It reduces need for intubation, surfactant and ventilation duration, and also significant reduction in bronchopulmonary dysplasia or death. Number needed to treat is 25. What about intubation? It is quite possible that a perivival or extremely low birth weight infant will need effective positive pressure ventilation and intubation for stabilization. But studies have demonstrated that although both about half of the 24-week gestation infant can be stabilized on CPAP in the delivery room, but very few babies escape intubation. They need intubation. But if you are intubating a baby and extremely low birth weight, use surfactant and then extubate and put the baby on CPAP. Or you can do, it is called as ensure technique. The next thing is surfactant deficiency. So when compared with early surfactant, that is prophylactic surfactant, against early or after baby develops some symptoms of respiratory distress. So early surfactant, there is no evidence to support this. So don't give prophylactic surfactant. Some babies who are 27, 28 weeks can do well without surfactant. So prophylactic or early surfactant is not recommended, but rescue surfactant can be given. The next thing is ensure. What is ensure? Intubate, give surfactant, extubate the baby, put the baby on CPAP. So need for subsequent mechanical ventilation after ensure was significantly reduced. 43 versus 85 in CPAP alone group. A meta-analysis of almost 1,500 infants comparing ensure plus CPAP versus CPAP alone did not show any significant difference in either death or BPD. Then this very hot topic nowadays in neonatology is least invasive surfactant administration. So there are two techniques, cringe technique and MIS technique. So we are going to see the video of this. This is a LISA, less invasive surfactant administration.
This film is taken as a video laryngoscope.
So this baby
demonstrates the position.
We should see the next video first.
This film.
Baby is on CPAP. Baby is already getting CPAP, and this doctor has intubated the laryngoscopy. He is passing a catheter, which is not an endotracheal tube, but a feeding tube like catheter, through the baby's open cord.
taken up with a megaphone and introduced
without incubating
of about 2
cm. You can see how they are doing it. So they have put a catheter into the baby's trachea.
To avoid too deep insertion can be clearly seen. In this film, the laryngoscope is slightly retracted but left in place during the procedure. The infant was a preterm baby with a birth weight of 600 grams on the first day of life. The baby received atropine to reduce secretion but no sedation. Throughout the procedure, the baby is breathing spontaneously, which is probably of prime importance for the success of this method. Towards the end of the film, some milky fluid, surfactant, can be seen in the larynx and reflux. A small amount of surfactant becomes evident when the catheter is.
So you need very skilled person for this. Lots of trials are going on about this, where we can prevent intubation in these babies. So another hot topic in neonatology is now quality improvement. So what impact this quality improvement can have on this outcome of these babies? So one Oxford network, in a before and after study design, compared outcomes between 2001 to 2003 in 19 hospitals. They reported that higher incidence of survival without BPD after initiation of better practices, 63% versus 53%. What they used? So less frequent conventional ventilation and postnatal steroids in this baby. Then increased use of CPAP, and very important, reduced median time for first surfactant dose from 22 hours to 10 minutes after delivery. 22 minutes to 10 minutes. So if you give surfactant very early, you can have better outcome in this baby. What is the role of giving caffeine early? So early use of caffeine is associated with less incidence of BPD and PDA. There is improved blood pressure and superior vena cava flow without any difference in need for intubation or vasopressors. Then what about oxygen use? What are the specific guidelines? So we follow this targeted saturation in babies. So don't expect saturation of 90% in a baby who is just 2 minutes or 1 minute old. So your saturation will become 90% only after 10 minutes. So you have to accept these saturations. At 5 minutes, the baby will have only saturation of 80 to 85, and that is acceptable. Don't hurry in giving oxygen to this baby. Then what are the guidelines? In term infant, start resuscitation with room air. If blended oxygen is not available, resuscitation should be initiated with air. In preterm or less than 35 weeks, should be initiated with low oxygen, that is 21 to 30%. And the oxygen titrated to achieve preductal oxygen saturation approximating the range achieved in a term baby. Because we don't have any range for extremely low birth weight babies, we are following whatever we have for the term babies. Initiating resuscitation of preterm newborn with higher oxygen is not recommended. So if just because baby is very preterm, you don't attach oxygen to the ambu bag. You start resuscitation without oxygen. If baby is not improving after say 1 or 2 minutes, then you attach oxygen to the ambu bag and then give oxygen to this baby. Best way is to give blended oxygen, and you can titrate the FiO2. So what is the evidence? There are recent meta-analysis of 677 preterm infants below 32 weeks showed there was no difference in morbidity in babies who were resuscitated with room air and those who resuscitated with 60% oxygen, a trend towards lower mortality in lower oxygen group. These data support the current NRP recommendations. So what cautions we should take? So what about cardiac compressions and medication use in these babies? For extremely low birth weight babies, compression and medications are prognostic markers for adverse neurodevelopmental outcomes. So extremely low birth weight baby who receives chest compression and medication in delivery room and have 15 minute apgar of less than 2 have only 14% chance of disability free survival. So it is very, very high morbidity. So what are the take home message from this talk? So we need very strong communication, teamwork. We should have medical knowledge as well as skills essential to resuscitate these babies. So ventilation is very important. Approximately 50% of these babies are hypothermic after admission to neonatal intensive care units. And active measures to avoid hypothermia are very important. Respiratory support at birth should aim to facilitate the early establishment of an effective functional residual capacity. So current neonatal resuscitation guidelines recommend the use of room air to 30% oxygen during neonatal resuscitation at birth. And the important goal is to provide least invasive support needed while always being prepared for the worst. Thank you very much. We have 10 minutes. If you have any questions, you can ask. Yes, sir. Good morning.
Are you using these
trials? We tried for feasibility of it, sir. But as I said, you need very skilled people because nowadays we intubate very rarely in the babies because most of the time we are doing non-invasive ventilation. So, always all the junior doctors will not be that efficient in doing intubation and giving surfactant in this baby. We tried for feasibility of it. Recently, I was in Bangalore. There was one study published there. And they showed that it is possible in our scenario also. But we need those specific catheters, which are very possible.
That is what I was asking. What type of catheter you have tried?
They showed their stiff catheters. We are using feeding tubes.
Yeah.
Infant feeding tube. They are not
there that. There are issues with the feeding tubes where our people have tried using Lisa in some of the babies. Because it is quite pliable and quite flexible.
Yes, sir.
So, can we use umbilical catheters or the suction catheters?
Yes, sir.
That is another way of trying issue. And some of the studies have been published there where they have used angiocath also.
Yes, bigger angiocath can be used. Yes, sir.
The 16 number.
Sanjay, my question is that anyway you are going to put something through the cord. Why not time-tested intubation, give the surfactant, remove the tube?
Just to avoid trauma to this baby because the
tube. Anyway, you said you require a high skilled personnel to do all these things. Most of us know how to do intubation and most of us can do it in a much better fashion. Rather than having these fancy things, why don't you just intubate, give the surfactant and remove it?
You have to put the endotracheal tube, then put another tube through that and use surfactant. You can save some time. See, all these are research going on. We don't have any strong evidence that this is
best.
But now we might get better
but
evidence.
Then the option of RISA is not available. This is the
yes, that is what we are doing. It is easily available, very cheap. Endotracheal tube. But what I said, we have to put the endotracheal tube first, then put another catheter through that and then push the surfactant. That time we can save. That's the only thing. And less trauma to the baby.
How will we assure that it will go only on the right side and not on the left side?
So those catheters have markings for spare, like the specific catheters for Lisa, they have markings. That marking should go up to the vocal cord. You should not push beyond that.
So then we need to put a position right at left side.
Nowadays, there is no need to change the position even if you are giving surfactant in a ventilated baby. Just put the baby in supine position and just do push surfactant. Dr. Sandeep Kadam wants to have some comment.
Sir, regarding your question about Lisa and versus Insure, when we are intubating, we are giving positive pressure ventilation. And in even little bit of positive pressure ventilation in preterm babies, like 25-26 weeks, is known to cause lung injury. So when we are doing LISA, we are giving CPAP or non-invasive ventilation using a catheter. And we are not disturbing the lungs in terms of giving more volume or more pressure. And when we look at the meta-analysis which have been published, LISA versus RISA for bronchopulmonary dysplasia and mortality, there is a significant reduction in the incidence of BPD or death compared to Insure. With Insure, we got reduction of 29%. With Lisa, the reduction is 48%. That's why people are opting to become less invasive for giving surfactant. And second issue was about position of the feeding tube. It should be at the level of vocal cords. Don't go beyond the vocal cords. So you don't go into right or left bronchus.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Aher. It was an interesting talk.